Okay. Professor Oliver Bültel obtained his PhD under the supervision of Richard Taylor from Oxford University in 1997. His area of research is arithmetic geometry, in particular Shimura varieties, and currently he is working at Universitat Duisburg-Essen. And anything you want to add, Oliver, to the
If people have time at the end of my talk, maybe I can chat a little bit more. But for the time being, this is I'd like to get started if
Okay.
everything is set up and if all participants have logged in now. Okay, may I?
Yes.
Okay, right. So the title of my talk you see over there. So let's go to the first slide. I have three sections. The first one is the introductory one, which is giving an overview about the history of the theory of Shimura varieties, including the contribution, which I think I can make. And the second part is basically about the proof of this thing. So it is using a weakening of a certain structure which people are used to call a moduli interpretation. And in the third part of my talk, I will try to indicate some related results and questions, which perhaps could be related to this weakened version of the moduli interpretation. So it started out from Ziegler space. So Mumford has written a famous book called Geometric Invariant Theory, in which he proved rigorously that the functor, which takes a scheme to the set of isomorphism classes of principally polarized abelian schemes of a relative dimension G with level n structure, is representable by a quasi-projective scheme over the integers with n inverted. So this is smooth and quasi-projective and gives thus has a very beautiful starting point for many developments. As people know, Shimura varieties and the Langlands project and counting of points over finite fields and things the like. The starting point is always this theorem. So over the complex numbers, things are easier to deal with than over general schemes. And this was done much earlier. So if we take the complex numbers as a ground field, then one can describe this in the following way. You are looking at a certain sub group of the symplectic group in 2G many variables, which you obtain as the centralizer of this thing here, which people call the delinear torus. And you also want an adelic analog of this. So this is a maximal compact subgroup. And of course, over other ground rings, for example, local fields, you can also have a maximal compact subgroup. And you could take this, for example. And if you
Excuse me, Oliver.
put this
Excuse
all
me.
together,
Could you please make your slides full screen?
Yeah, I know there was a little lag. So is it
No, I mean, if
can
full
you see it
screen.
better
So if you
now?
No, but because there is some distracting things on your desktop, if you just could make
Okay.
the slides full screen. So if you go fencer maybe, or if you click on the green circle on the left-hand side.
Neue Freigabe. Let's
Okay.
try neue Freigabe.
mean, if you go to the
try randomly,
on your window.
Let me try something randomly here. Is this better?
Exactly. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. I only need a little motivation and then I get it done. Right. Exactly. This was what I was looking before, but I didn't find it. I don't understand why it works now. Okay. So this is called Siegel space. let me try this here. No. Yeah. Okay. So as I said, there's a theorem of Riemann that is able to characterize a abelian variety in terms of so-called period relations. So in modern language, this is just a quotient of the so-called Siegel double half space, which is denoted by H, G plus minus, which you find here. And since there's some ambiguity of choosing the periods, you have a group acting on the left. And since there's also a level structure being fixed, you have this K upper infinity on the right. Just recall K upper infinity, that was the kernel of the map from the symplectic group over the profinite ring to the ring Z modulo NZ. And this is a complex analytic description of the same thing. So we have a very interesting algebraic variety, which over the complex numbers can be written as a quotient of some well-known thing here. This is so-called bounded symmetric domain by some congruent subgroup. So let's go on. So what are now the integral models, conjectures. Here we have once more the Linus Nielsen of Shimura datum axiomatizes all these things. So the double quotient that I've told you a second ago can be done for a large class of groups. You only need to know that there exists X. X is called a bounded symmetric domain, and it doesn't exist for a general Lie group. It has to fulfill certain axioms, which Satake and Deligne exhibited. And it's now known as the axioms of Deligne. And the projective limit acquires the structure of an algebraic variety, which you can prove, for example, by using Bailey-Borel. Yeah, you look at the ring of modular forms on this, and then Bailey-Borel takes a project of this homogeneous ring, and they prove that this gives an algebraic description of this double quotient over the complex numbers, of course. So, but in arithmetic, you don't want complex numbers, you want number fields. And this is how the theorem of Deligne, Milne, and Borovoy comes into play. It's very deep and the proof is rather long and complicated. So it says the following. So if Gx is a Shimura datum, and if K infinity is a choice of level structure, then the double quotient, which I now write MGX for it. This is a quasi-projective variety over C, of course, by Bailey-Borel, but it possesses a model over the reflex field E. The reflex field E is a certain subfield of the complex numbers. It is a number field, and in many cases, it's just Q. In some strange cases, it's a bit bigger than Q, particularly if the group, you don't really have to know this, if the group is an inner form of if the group has outer forms, which means that the Dynkin diagram has a symmetry, for example, orthogonal groups in an even number of variables or also the linear groups, or E6, for example. E6 is also a case of a group where the reflex field is a little bit bigger. And next question is, has it good reduction at a prime number? And all these miraculous things that one is doing in the Langlands program suggests the answer, because if you have an automorphic representation that has a spherical vector for a hyperspecial subgroup, then you expect the corresponding Galois representation to be unramified at a certain prime. So it's very natural to expect that in this case, well, meaning that you have at P a hyperspecial group, that in this case you have good reduction. Actually at P, or if in case the reflex field is not Q, then you would expect also that the reduction is good at all primes over P. And this conjecture is open. It's not known in general. So here it is more specifically. To be on the safe side, I want to assume G is anisotropic. It's a silly trick to avoid cheating on the concept of good reduction, because anisotropic groups, let me explain this, anisotropic groups give rise to compact Shimura varieties. A minute ago, I mentioned Bailey Borel, who compactified all Shimura varieties by adding boundary strata at infinity. So this is necessary because you need the compactification for the definition of the concept of modular forms, which in turn also enters in the algebraic description, because you want to take the proch of the ring of modular forms. However, in this setting, it has a slightly different meaning. So if there's no boundary at all, then you can simply say a variety has good reduction if it extends as a proper and smooth model over a semi-local numbering. If it was not proper or not compact synonymously, then one is a little bit in trouble, because you could choose some model, you could look at the singular locus and you could simply remove it. If the thing is not compact anyway, then removing a little bit more or a little bit less will not change this from being a model. So that's why it's a convenient assumption to have. So if G is anisotropic, there's a cool way to describe the concept of good reduction, and just saying that it extends to a projective and smooth model over the semi-local numbering. Of course, there are more clever versions of phrasing that a Shimura variety has good reduction, but this is slightly involved, and it was introduced by Milne. It's the so-called extension property, which is relevant at this point, but for my talk, this is totally fine. So good reduction in the next 60 minutes just means it has a proper model, and it is smooth, and it extends to a proper model over the semi-local numbering, of which the special fiber is still smooth and proper, of course. Okay, so let me go to the next slide. Right, so this is the thing I came up with. So let's look at a prime P, not two, to be on the safe side, and fix an embedding of the unique unramified extension of the P adic number field of degree F into the complex numbers. And now you look at the Shimura datum, which satisfies the following things. So the derived group over QP, I want to be simply connected and quasi-split and almost simple of type E7, say. There are a few other things where this approach works, but let's fix on E7 at the moment. And I also want that the adjoint group possesses more than one factor. So it means automatically that the group is almost simple, but not absolutely almost simple, because over a extension, it has several factors. And in particular, over the real, I want to have it at least five factors. I meant six. And for example, one of them non-compact and the other one compact, then this condition is fulfilled. Yeah, so the proportion of compact factors as opposed to the non-compact ones must be four or bigger. And I also want that splits over over this extension. This is not too difficult to achieve. Any group splits over this if it is unramified. You only have to make f big enough. And then the theorem tells you that it has good reduction. So there exists a compact open subgroup at P. Unfortunately, there's some existential quantification on the level structure at P, which is a little bit awkward, but I will say a little bit more about it in the future. So given this, you can pick any compact open subgroup away from P in the RDLs, and for any level structure which is made up by combining this fixed compact open group with this variable compact open group away from P, that this always has good reduction at a certain place which I fix. Yeah? So I first fix the place and then I do this. So how is this proved? So observe that the Shimura variety of type E7 is not of Hodge type. So the previously known result cannot be applied. So in particular, the theorem of Vasiu or the theorem of Kiesin fail because there's no moduli interpretation in terms of abelian varieties. So the methods of Borovoy, Milne, Kasdan, and Bailey-Borel do not fail, however. So you still have a canonical model of a number field, but it does not give the good reduction property. So let me go to the next slide. And now I want to explain how this theorem is proved. And I want to begin with a sloppy and informal discussion of Hodge cycles and, of course, absolute Hodge cycles. Hodge cycles and absolute Hodge cycles are an issue for Shimura varieties of Hodge type. Notice once more that the group E7 is not a Shimura variety of Hodge type. However, the way I prove it requires certain methods which as an auxiliary tool also use some absolute Hodge cycles. So this is the next slide here. So let me just remind you what the pure Hodge structure is. It's supposed to be equipped with a weight, which is an integer usually. And then you have a finite dimensional pure vector space, which is equipped with a decomposition over the complex numbers, which looks like this here, indexed by two integers p and q, of which the sum is n, and you have the axiom that vqp is the complex conjugate of vpq. A typical example is the Tate twist. You have as a vector space, you take 2i pi and you tensor it n over 2 many times, and this is denoted by q twist n over 2. So this is a Hodge structure of weight n. Yeah, so q twist 1, for example, is of weight 2. So why is this relevant? There's a famous conjecture due to Hodge. We have a smooth projective complex variety, and then one knows that the q vector space of Betti cohomology possesses a Hodge structure in the natural way. It follows from the Dirac theorem, which tells you that the singular cohomology of an algebraic variety over the complex numbers can also be described by the cohomology of a certain complex of differential forms. And Hodge proved that this gives rise to the interesting filtration on the cohomology. So here are two theorems which are usually connected with the theory of Hodge cycles. So you have a morphism from H, from the two-piece cohomology to Q twist minus P in the category of Hodge structures. So the morphism is supposed to preserve the the pieces, and all of this must arise from a linear combination of p-dimensional subvarieties. So it's the Hodge cycles in this thing. You have to twist this with p actually. They are related to the space of algebraic cycles, and the linear has proved an interesting substitute of this. So if you have a cycle, then you can apply the complex conjugation or any other automorphism of the field of complex numbers, and you usually spot that the conjugation of this cycle is again an algebraic cycle, because you can apply your field automorphism to the coefficients of the equations that are defining your cycle. And that shows that the algebraic cycle is not just Hodge in the sense of the Hodge conjecture, but its conjugates are also Hodge. And the linear has proven that these two concepts are the same for the special case of abelian varieties. So if you have an abelian variety and defined over the complex numbers, for example, and you take a Hodge cycle, then it gives rise to an element in this cohomology group here, and one knows that the conjugates of this are still Hodge cycles. So this is by the linear. It's proven in the famous book called Motifs, Shimura Varieties, and Taniyama Groups, and with a title like this. It's a lecture notes series in volume 900. And let me now explain to you how I apply it. So suppose L is a CM field of finite degree over Q, and suppose that we are given three principally polarized abelian varieties of dimension n1, n2, and n3, multiplied with the degree of the field extension. And then I want to call such a triple multipliable if for every embedding from L into the complex numbers, at least one of the three eigenspaces of the Lie algebras of y1, y2, or y3 vanishes. So this is a condition not on an abelian variety, but three of them. So in this case, a little Hodge theoretic exercise tells you that you can form the tensor product of the period lattice of these abelian varieties, and you obtain indeed another, again, the period lattice of an abelian variety. Now, again, I seem to have a problem with this, with my window here. It's a slightly too.
Go to a scale. Do you see a scale next to the printer icon?
Escape, yes.
On the top, there's this little scale. I think if you scale it down a little, maybe it works. Do you know on the top?
You mean you're suggesting to press escape?
I mean, on the left hand side, there's a printer icon. Do you see it? On the top of your window.
Oh, hang on. Yes.
There is an escape. If you escape it down. No.
Right.
There's a operation.
Scale.
No, you should hit abbrechen.
This is the scale.
Yes.
So I just put a smaller number here, 250, for example.
And hit enter.
Oh no, hang on. Oh, I see. Ah, thank you. Mm-hmm. This is better now, isn't it? Do you see the lowest line here?
Yes.
All right. So you take the three Hodge structures and you tensor them up and you twist with -1, and then one can prove using simple considerations that the result is again a Hodge structure of weight minus one. And exactly these Hodge structures are needed for period levels. Well, it's there's one little detail I swiped under the rug. In order to get an actual abelian variety from a Hodge structure, you need not only the Hodge structure itself, but you need the property that there's a so-called Riemannian form on it, which is having this is a little bit equivalent to the Riemann-Pierret relations. And there's a crucial positivity condition for this thing. It's called a polarization. But again, you can show if these things are equipped with polarizations, then the tensor product is again a polarization on this gadget here. So it gives you a abelian variety over the complex numbers. Now, using the linear, you can do this over arbitrary fields, different from C. And using the aforementioned results of Vasio and Kiesing, you can also do this over fields of characteristic P. Now, this is my next slide. So the relationship between these four abelian varieties, the three input ones and the tensor product one, can be expressed by saying that there's an interesting Hodge cycle in the cohomology of these. And by the linear, this is the absolute Hodge structure. And so it is it's an algebraic construction. It's however round, the definition is rather roundabout, but it, at the end of the day, it's an algebraic construction, which also works over fields of characteristic P, as long as P is unramified and odd. Right, there's a little proposition you want to prove about these things. Suppose the L-addictate module is defined in this way, and suppose we have now a abelian variety over a field of characteristic P, then there are three interesting compatibilities which I am going to use in the rest of my talk. First of all, the tensor product of the Tate module is compatible in this way. So you just tensor them up and twist with one. And the tensor product of the Dieudonné modules has the same property. And also the tensor product of the endomorphism algebras preserves the property of being an endomorphism. To prove this is actually a little bit tricky, because if y1, y2, and y3 were all defined over a field of characteristic zero, you could of course argue by using the Hodge structures, but over a field of characteristic p, you can't do this. And the trouble is that you can't even lift endomorphisms from characteristic p to characteristic zero. So you have to use a little bit of trickery. The idea is that you use the Cayley transformation, which sends skew symmetric elements in here to self quasi isogenies, and self quasi isogenies you can lift by allowing the target and the source of this thing to be two different abelian varieties, and then you can prove this little proposition. Now, this is enough about the tensor product of abelian varieties. And now I'm in the position to explain what the polyunitary Shimura datum is for a Shimura datum which is not of Hodge type. So you fix a hyperspecial subgroup in G0, where G0 is a group of which the scalar restriction is G. And so L plus is typically totally real field, and you want to choose a totally imaginary quadratic extension of this, which I want to call L. And P is automatically unramified in L plus because of the assumptions on G0, which I already made before. But the L that you choose in this way, I want to be unramified at P2. Now, the next ingredient is a very crucial one. You pick three representations, each of which endowed with a skew Hermitian polarization. And you do it in such a way that G0 is recovered from the stabilizers of the endomorphism algebras of V1, V2, V3, and their tensor product. groups which can be recovered from the endomorphism algebra of vector space are, of course, the classical groups. If V only has one polarization and some endomorphism algebra, then this would give the theory of PEL Shimura varieties. However, because I'm allowing the tensor product of three representations, this can be a bit, this contains much more examples. In fact, one can show, and it's not very hard, that every algebraic group can be written as the stabilizer of a of its endomorphisms for three sophisticatedly chosen representations. And the motivation for this comes from the following. If you have a Shimura variety, then the linear expects that it is a moduli interpretation for motives. And for every representation of the group, you would get, you are expecting a motive over the Shimura variety. Now, if that motive happens to be an abelian variety, then you can then you might want to take the tensor product, and you have another motive. And if you are lucky and you reobtain G0 as this stabilizer of this thing, then you can then you have an almost PEL modular problem in some sense. There's another ingredient which is very crucial, and it's an ideal. I want an ideal in the localization of L plus at all places away from P. So up to some silly things, it's just the power of P. This ideal is very important for the polyunitary Shimura datum, and it does not have an analog for the usual setting. The reason is it's slightly subtle, and I hope I'm able to explain it in a few minutes. So please bear this in mind. It's called F. It's some kind of conductor, basically. So here's the next slide. So given the conductor F and given the group G0 and these three funny representations, you can write down a moduli problem. It goes like this. So the input datum is just schemes over well, your preferred base here is the wit ring of, I write W for the wit ring. I take W of the field of degree P to the F. And now over this thing, I have the following structure. I want a multipliable triple of polarized abelian schemes over S with OL operation, of course. And well, if they are multipliable, it cries for writing down the product. I denote it by this thing here. And on this, I may or may not have additional endomorphisms. And I just put that into the moduli space. So as an algebra, I take the endomorphism algebra of my three preferred representations. These German style Vs are supposed to be lattices in the Latin style Vs. And I have to be very cautious with the choice of order. I can't just take the endomorphism algebra of this thing over ZP, say. That would be too easy. I have to make the order deliberately smaller, and this is how the F comes into play. So otherwise, the theory would not have a lot of content. I mean, the reason is subtle, and again, it will come up in the next few slides. And also there's an analog of level structure. Of course, the V plays the role of the period lattice, and so V modulo NV plays the role of the N torsion points, and you want to have isomorphisms between this, and they better be compatible with all these additional stuff that you have chosen here. So this is a polyunitary Shimura datum. It's basically a subvariety of the product of three unitary group Shimura varieties. And it's defined by the additional condition that on the tensor product abelian variety, which of course doesn't exist in general, but it does exist in the multipliable case, acquires this sort of additional endomorphism ring. So that's a polyunitary Shimura datum.
Can I interrupt you for a second? Sorry.
Is there a question?
So I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes. So you define the tensor product of this multipliable RBM, right? Mm-hmm. Over complex numbers using the Hodge structures, right?
Yes, exactly.
But
yes.
Mm-hmm. If you have now abelian varieties over some arbitrary or abelian schemes on some arbitrary scheme S, how do you define them?
Well, you can argue with the theorem of Kiesin. So you have a three unitary group Shimura varieties and a fourth one, which is given by the Hodge structure of these product things, and you have a canonical morphism between that, and so it extends to characteristic P, because you can apply Kiesin's theorem to the graph of a morphism. So then think of four unitary Shimura varieties, three of them playing the role for the input abelian varieties, Y1, Y2, Y3, and the potential outcome you view as a point on some third unitary group Shimura varieties. So it's just a question on whether a certain morphism between these Shimura varieties extends to characteristic P. And you can do this by the theorem of Kiesin, which says that Shimura varieties of Hodge type have good reduction. It's an example of a Shimura variety of Hodge type, basically, because you can think of the three unitary groups as sitting in the product of four unitary groups. And the dictionary between homomorphisms and subvarieties that goes from the homomorphism to the subvariety by looking at the graph will give you this. In fact, one doesn't really need to invoke the theorem of Kiesin. There's also a proof for it, which is independent of this, which I've done in a paper of mine.
Thank you.
So you're welcome. Okay, next slide is now the proof. I'd like to do a little digression to the theory of displays. So it goes like this. You have a reductive group scheme over the integers localized at P, and you have a co-character of this reductive group scheme over the unique unramified extension of degree F. And you require that the weights of this in the Lie algebra are contained in the set minus 1, 0, 1. If this condition is fulfilled, the co-character is called minuscule. To this data, one associates a canonical stack called BG mu. So its points over an algebraically closed field are given by the quotient. So you take the double coset G of the width ring times mu of p times g of the width ring, and you take the quotient by the so-called f conjugation. Two elements in this thing, or perhaps even in the whole of g, are called f conjugated if you can write one of them as g inverse times b times Frobenius applied to g. So this is called the stack of G mu displays. Of course, for general rings, it has to be defined in a more complicated way. There are all kinds of issues coming up, torsors and things like this. But over algebraically closed field, it is just like this. It's a set which comes up already in very old papers of Kottwitz and Rappoport and these people. So this is a rather popular thing. It's being worked on a lot. Me and Heda Yatzadeh and Lau and Pappas have done something on these things. And there's the expectation which one has, the integral models of a Shimura variety, they are expected to allow a morphism to this stack, where G and mu is defined as follows. So the G is the reductive model of the G over the field with the property that if you put in ZP, you just get the level structure KP. And mu is a certain homomorphism that arises from the Shimura datum. This is easier to see. This is already explained in the paper of Deligne. If you have a Shimura datum, then you always have a minuscule co-character, which is usually called mu x or mu h or whatever. So we want want Shimura variety models together with a morphism to BG mu. It's the analog of asking to have an abelian variety together with its p-divisible group. And therefore, it's a very natural thing to do. I must admit that I don't know for which integral models this expectation is known and written up, but for the examples for which I use it, I prove it in my paper. But it might very well be that experts know how to do this for an arbitrary Shimura variety of Hodge type using the methods of Kiesin and Vasiu. I don't know. I haven't thought about it so well. So anyway, the expectation is used to construct the Shimura variety from the German style M. So recall that German style M is this funny polyunitary Shimura datum with this moduli space consisting of, you know, three abelian varieties with an endomorphism acting on the tensor product. And in order to turn this into a Shimura variety, you'd rather have a map to BG mu. And you would like to link these two things, this and this you want to link. And the idea is to pass to a covering space. And for this, of course, you need a map, which I call flex, from the BG mu, which is classically defined in the papers of Heda Yatsade, myself, Pappas, and Lau, to let's call it the P edification of the modular space M. And recall that M is defined as three abelian varieties with an action on the tensor product, and German style B, well, what is this? It's three P divisible groups with an action on the tensor product, P divisible group. It's just the same as M. However, each time you come across the word abelian variety, you replace this by P divisible group. And thanks to a wonderful theorem of Eike Lau, you can even replace P divisible group by display. So this is how I think of BF. BF is the moduli space which takes three displays and of course multipliable one and an action on the tensor product. Okay, and you want that these properties are fulfilled. The horizontal morphisms have to be formally etal, and this one must be radical and universally closed. So heuristically, it means this and this is almost the same. Otherwise you couldn't have this morphism to be radical. In particular, naively, it means it's an injection, because for perfect fields, you have an injective map of stacks. Right, so let me go to the next slide here. So two questions arise. How do you define flex? And of course, you also want to prove the existence of an integral model. So this thing, I mean, once you have this diagram, the integral model follows rather easily, because this is formally etal, and by some trickery with deformation theory of displays, which has been studied a lot, you can lift this in such a way that on the lift you still have a map to BG mu, and using the existence theorem of Grothendieck, you get that it is algebraic, and then you are in business, because you look at the covering space and you apply the Warshawski theorems to the covering space, And on the covering space, you have the deck transformation, and you simply apply theorems on arithmetic groups to the group of deck transformations. This style is rather complicated, but it is not so new, because this is exactly the way that Borovoy and Kasdan and Milne and Bailey-Borel prove the canonical models thing. You know, I just to remind you, for a couple of slides ago, I pointed out this theorem. Due to Bailey-Borel, Delin, Milne, and Borovoy, one could add a few other names, Kasdan, for example, and Vasovsky, of course. And this is proved in exactly the same way. You take an automorphism of the complex numbers, you apply it to the Shimura variety, and then you get something new. You get an algebraic variety, which may or may not be a Shimura variety, and you study the universal covering space of this, and you study the group of deck transformations, and you want to prove that the universal covering space of this is still a bounded symmetric domain, and you want to prove that the group of deck transformations is also a congruent subgroup. And in so doing, you obtain that the complex conjugations of Shimura varieties are still Shimura varieties. And this is already 90% of having proved this theorem. It's called the conjugation conjecture of Langlands. And the methods which are applied here are exactly the same as the methods used here. So it looks intimidating, but it is well understood classical mathematics. So let me go to something which is more subtle and relatively recent. It's this map flex, which is sort of the crux for it. In order to set up the diagram, you need the polyunitary Shimura variety. You need the stack of displays. You take the p-edification of the moduli space of this polyunitary moduli space, and you want to have a map from there to there. And the map is constructed in the following way. I need a couple of lemmas. So I explained it only for algebraically closed fields. For general rings, of course, it's slightly more complicated, but there's no essential difficulty. You just have to put torsors everywhere and perhaps projective modules instead of vector spaces. So recall that the F-crystal over an algebraically closed field of characteristic P is a pair consisting of a finitely generated torsion-free module over the Wittring and a Frobenius linear injective map, which is usually called F. Now I have the following lemma. Consider a grading on such an F crystal of an algebraically closed field, and I want the grading to satisfy the following crucial property. If I apply F to MI, then I want to get to MI plus one. You know, this is nothing to be surprised about, because gradings of crystals reflect actions of little rings here. Please read this remark for a while here. Notice that giving a gradation on the F crystal over K is just equivalent to giving an action of the ring with vectors over the field extension of degree R. This is because if you tensor this with the with ring, you get R copies of it. It's a usual thing, sometimes called it's called Morita equivalence or something like this. So this is nothing particularly exciting, but the condition that F of MI is equal to MI plus one has some meaning. It means that in the Shimura variety language, this is a compact factor, because the Hodge polygon is related to the minuscule co-character. And if the Hodge polygon is trivial, I mean, the quotient of the target by the image is a torsion group which encodes the Hodge polygon. So if this group is trivial, it means the Hodge polygon is trivial. And in the Shimura language, this means that your minuscule co-character is trivial for this. And to just remember the conditions at the beginning, I said that the group G must have many compact factors. No, this thing here, G possesses more than four times as many compact factors than non-compact ones. This is an this you should bear in the back of your mind, because each time you have a compact factor of your group, it means that the crystal which are coming up in this business have a graded Frobenius, which is a bijection. Because bijection means the Hodge polygon is trivial, and a trivial Hodge polygon means the group is compact. So of course you don't want it for all I, but only for all I different from zero. Okay, so for zero, you want exactly the opposite behavior. So it's a very irregular Hodge polygon. It's compact for many places, and for one place, I mean, namely zero, it is f of m0 is sandwiched between m1 and p to the w times m1, where w is some number. So if the joke is, if w is small in comparison to r, you can change the lattice in some horrible way. I have given you the formula here, in such a way that the changed lattice loses the property of having compact factors, but it gains the property of being a Dieudonné module. Recall that a Dieudonné module is a F-crystal where the image of Frobenius is sandwiched between M and P times M, rather than P to the some power. So you sort of, you distribute the Hodge polygon over the whole of the places. And this is what this lemma does. And it's called, let's call it the Dieudonnéification of a F crystal, of which has only one single non-compact factor, and of which the weight is smaller than R, R being the degree of the grading. So there's a silly corollary that you have. Suppose you have three graded F crystals, K, L, and M, and all satisfy the assumptions, then you can do you can prove this in three different ways, where here is some elbow room to manipulate it a little bit. So you can do it in such a way that you get three different Dieudonné modules with having all these properties, and having one more property, namely that their tensor product is again a Dieudonné module. So this is what I would call a multipliable triple of a Dieudonné lattices. In fact, if you have a multipliable triple of abelian varieties, and if you look at the Dieudonné modules of these, then they will also satisfy this property. So you can think of it as a way to produce Dieudonné modules of multipliable triples of abelian varieties. Yeah, but here the inequality you need is a slightly tougher. This times R is not only bigger than W, but it must be bigger than three times W. The three comes up because, well, it's clear because you have three these lattices. And just recall the definition of multipliability involves that the interesting non-compact places are disjoint. So you need three times as much space to do the Dieudonnéification. Now, the definition of flex is now not so difficult. I restrict to the simplest possible case. Let's say that P is inert in this totally real field L plus, but split in L, so that we have a decompositions like this, right? I mean, over, if we take the ring of integers and we tensor with ZP, then we get the Wittring. And if we do the same thing with L rather than L plus, then we get the Wittring twice. So observe that this decomposition also induces a splitting of the unitary representations. The extension L over L plus is responsible for a certain unitary representation. And if I look at this over ZP, and if I assume that P splits in L, then you can just as well view the unitary representation as an ordinary linear representation, because a unitary group base changes over to a linear group over the field. And I also want to have that the mu weights of this representations are contained in this set. So this is the assumption. Recall that these row I's are the V's which I've chosen in the polyunitary Shimura datum. Yeah, just a couple of slides ago, there was this thing which are called a polyunitary Shimura datum. So this has got row I's. I mean, and these row I's I take and put them over ZP, and then I require this. And now here's the definition of flex. So you first take an object in BG mu. So let me recall the definition of BG mu. It is basically this thing. It is the double coset modulo the equivalence relation of F conjugacy. So you have an element B in this thing. So you can also view it as a crystal with G structure. Second step is this. You have these three representations cooked up from the group of the polyunitary Shimura datum and the respective representations. And by applying them to B, you get F crystals. This is just because the formation of BG mu is functorial with change of group. Now rho is a homomorphism from G to some GLN. Well, a few slides ago, it was a unitary group, but from now on, it is a linear group because L is assumed to be split. So I have these things and I plugging in B, I get an element of B G mu where G is not the G I started out from, but simply a GLN. And an element like this with G being GLN is nothing but a crystal. So I have three crystals, K, L, and M. And moreover, the Hodge polygon of these crystals reflects the behavior of mu. And since mu is assumed to have all places compact with but one exception, I can apply this corollary and turn these three lattices, these three F crystals, I can turn into Dieudonné modules by doing exactly this construction, the L prime and K prime and M prime thing. So what do I get? I get three Z mod R Z graded Dieudonné modules, K prime, L prime, and M prime. But now I have to be a little bit careful because on K, L, and M, I had the action of the endomorphism algebra of V1, V2, and V3. And since passage from the K to K prime and from L to L prime and from M to M prime, this is not quite functorial. So you don't necessarily get an action of the endomorphism algebra of this on the K prime, L prime, and M prime. However, because these things are sandwiched between each other, just look at this, equation here. It tells you M is not too far away from M prime. So people who like the theory of Bruhard-Tietz buildings would phrase it in the way that the distance between M and M prime in the Bruhard-Tietz building is bounded by a constant. W minus one in this case, but it doesn't really matter so much which constant. You have these crystals, K, L, and M, and you have the algebra acting on it, and you have the Dieudonnification of these crystals, K prime, L prime, and M prime. And now the same algebra would not act, but if you are deliberately allowed to make the order a little bit smaller, then it still acts because of this formula here. Yeah, if you multiply everything with a sufficiently big power of P here, then it gets you back to, M prime always lands in M. And if you are in M, you get into M prime by multiplying with P, with some power of P here. So this is the idea of the conductor. So the Dieudonnification, which is nothing but the the activity of this functor flex. This violates the endomorphism algebra, but it violates it in a very controlled way. So some slightly smaller order, which is obtained in a specific way by multiplying with a strange power of p, will still regain the endomorphism algebra. And now here's the definition of flex. You take this element B, you take these three Diodonny lattices, K prime, L prime, and M prime, together with this action of this strange order on them. And well, this is the definition of flex, you know, it's and you the covering space for the poorly unitary abelian variety can be obtained in such a way. So you have a crystal with G structure. You have a Diodonification of the realizations by means of row one, row two, and row three. And at the same time, you have three abelian varieties in the background, and you want that the Diodonné modules of these three abelian varieties exactly look like K prime, L prime, and M prime. Observe that K, L, and M themselves could never ever be Diodonné modules of abelian varieties simply because their Hodge polygon is not sufficient for this. But the Diodonification of K, L, and M do allow algebraic varieties of which the Diodonny module are these things. And recall that the poorly unitary Shimura problem also required an action on the tensor product abelian variety. And of course, you require that this is the same here. I mean, otherwise it wouldn't be a map. Okay, right. So at the end, I would like to phrase some open questions. Of course, the most pressing question is the more precise determination of KP. The trouble is when in the middle of the proof, you use some very hard theorems of Prasad and Warshawski. And in the middle of doing this, the knowledge of KP just gets lost. I mean, it's just too deep to reveal explicit information of KP. So I'm hoping to recover KP in the following way. You use P Eddie Koch theory to describe not just one layer, but the infinite towers of the whole Shimura variety. And you do this as KP varies. And if you have the whole tower for all level structures, then I think it will become obvious how to prove that KP is indeed a hyperspecial subgroup. And well, this is the second question: is the level structure occurring in theorem 5 hyperspecial? I certainly conjecture the answer as yes, because otherwise it couldn't possibly yield a Shimura variety of good reduction. But from the bureaucratic viewpoint, this is not an outcome of this theorem. It still has to be proven. And the third question I would like to raise is whether the adelic representations coming from local systems on this thing, whether they are perhaps crystalline. So there's a relatively recent theorem of Ruohuan Liu and Qin Wenchu in Inventiones, which shows that these representations are Deram. But I conjecture in the case at hand that they should be crystalline rather than Deram. So next, two questions is whether maybe one can perhaps use the Linnaeus theory of absolute Hodge cycles also in characteristic P. So this was addressed in a couple of papers of Milne. And if one had this, you could simply get rid of this business with the three abelian varieties that you have to take the tensor product of, and a lot of other things would be a little bit easier too. And the theory of absolute Hodge cycles in positive characteristic, which unfortunately does not yet seem to exist, this could also be used to prove that the containment of the endomorphism algebras. So you want that the tensor product of these three algebras is contained in this. This is very important. This the point at which I use it, I hasn't become clear in my talk, but as a matter of fact, let me point it out at the end of my talk. So the trouble is that if you have a polyunitary moduli problem, this thing here, polyunitary Shimura, oops, not this one. Where is it? Here, right. Not so obvious, but relatively easy to prove that in characteristic zero, this thing is just the empty set. So that raises the question whether perhaps it's also in characteristic P, the empty set. If it was, then of course one would be in trouble because the whole proof would crash. If this was empty, this would be empty. And then I would have proven that the empty set has good reduction, which is of course not what one wants. There should be at least one point on it. And the non-emptiness of the special fiber of the polyunitary Shimura moduli problem, this is proved with this this proposition here. Yeah, the fact that the tensor product endomorphism algebra is contained in the endomorphism algebra of the Abelian varieties, this is used for the non-emptiness of the moduli problem M. So usually non-emptiness of Shimura moduli problems is used by appealing to the theory of CM points, but CM points are characteristic zero constructions. And the trouble is this thing does unfortunately not have any points in characteristic zero. Well, I'm basically through with my slides, so perhaps I should allow some questions or remarks.
Can I ask a question? Do you hear me? Can I ask a question?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
So thank you very much for the talk. It was very interesting. And to what extent do you use, or your proof is based on previous works of Kissing and Vazu and the integral models of Shimura varieties of Hodge type or Abelian type?
Oh, on a technical level, I do not use any of these papers. It comes up indirectly by the construction of the tensor product Abelian varieties, but this also can be done with a paper which I have proved in my habilitation thesis, and this preceded the stuff of Kissing and Vazio. Of course, its ideas owe a lot to Kissing and Vazio, but on a technical level, I do not use the existence of integral canonical models in the Hodge type setting. I only use the functoriality of integral canonical models, and this is much easier. One can do this.
So then I come to my next question. So do you think this method could be used to prove the results of Kissing? Construct integral models of
because the assumptions are very, very peculiar. For example,
in this situations where you could get something of Hodge type, not arbitrary Shimura.
Let me see. You need a polyunitary Shimura datum for this machinery to work. Hang on. Yes, I think there are some overlaps. I mean, I think there are some special cases of the Kiesin-Vasio integral models story, which could also be proved with these methods. But I haven't made it explicit. One would have to generalize it. The polyunitary moduli problem is, of course, it's slightly artificial. I have many choices. I have these three modules, and I have to choose my field L, and I have to choose representations, and it's a rather indirect way to look at things. So I think it's not desirable to apply this to a Shimura variety of Hodge-type, because Shimura varieties of Hodge-type are accessible with much better methods. But there are some overlaps. So if you replace L by a quaternion algebra, for example, then I could quite imagine that certain examples of orthogonal Shimura varieties, which are usually considered as the prime examples of the Kiesin-Vasio stuff, I could well imagine that this can be that the integral models can be proved in two different ways. I mean, in the Kiesin-Vasio way, but also with these things. That would be an interesting project to do. I mean, at some point I tried to figure out what the intersection is between this approach. I mean, you would not take a poorly unitary Shimura datum because that's way too complicated. You would take something that's slightly similar. I mean, only one abelian variety, but it would still, but this trick that you change the Hodge polygon by means of a map flex, this is still has something to say also for Shimura varieties of Hodge type. And that could be an interesting project to carve out a theorem that lies in the intersection of the Kiesian and Vasio thing and with this stuff. So it would be a Shimura variety of Hodge type then, which modulo P has some artificial PEL moduli problem. So this exists, I'm relatively sure. But I would have to sit down and think exactly about the assumptions. In fact, at some point I cheated a little bit. For example, the levels, there's some problem with the level structure here. Of course, you really want the idyllic version of this, but in my paper, I allow the etas not only to be isomorphisms, but which respect the Riemann form, they are allowed to multiply it with an element of L plus, which one has to choose and which one has to fix. Because otherwise, you would again get the slight problem with the non-emptiness. So, but again, I think basically there are relevant things in the intersection between this approach and the Kiesin-Vasio approach.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Mm-hmm.
There is a construction of prismatic cohomology by Schulz and Bott, which need you first fix a prism, which is basically a frame. And this cohomology theory is specialization to much known cohomology theories. For example, it is a frame, and so a prismatic cohomology is a P module with a Nygaard iteration, so it should give rise to a higher display on the one hand, and it specializes to a Hodge structure on the other hand. So do you think you can use this theory to describe the, for example, PID compilation of your integral model more directly? I mean, without using the theorem about the deformation theory and leave the thing you had in characteristics PU define it directly at the mixed characteristics.
I must admit that I'm still trying to learn the theory of Scholz. So, I presume your question refers a little bit to the last but one slide on the P. Edekotsch theory here. Of course, this is very desirable. Occasionally I think about it. For a long time, I tried to do it by using the paper of Faltings in the John Hopkins book. But I haven't gotten very far with it. And I think it maybe the Scholz stuff gives a fresh and more direct approach to it. I have the feeling that it's not that difficult, but of course, I shouldn't say it really before I come up with something specific. I must admit I don't really know. You might be right, but I'm not sure. Maybe we should talk further, and I'd like to understand your question in greater detail. But at my head, I cannot say too much about it, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Okay, thanks for a beautiful talk. So may I also ask a question, or maybe a couple of questions?
Of course, yes, please. I'm eager on questions.
Mm-hmm. The first question is somehow somewhat the same with that of Mohammad Hadi. So the point, maybe I mixed things up. Because the conditions I have seen at the beginning was some sort of weird to me. So it's not clear the comparison with the Kissings. Case. Still maybe you can say a few more words in that direction just comparing things with how far we can go beyond that.
Yes. Okay. I certainly should be more should give more information on this. So right. So perhaps you remember the slide at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. So I explained what it meant for an algebraic variety to have a good reduction. So you have something which is you have an adjoint, this thing here of length lengths. So this is, of course, a very naive viewpoint. And what Kiesen and Vasio do is much better. They don't only prove that this has good reduction, they prove that there's a so-called integral canonical model. Mm-hmm. And this has to be defined. The definition goes back to James Milne. It turned out to be incorrect, and it was corrected by Vasio. Mm-hmm. And so that means that you have some kind of extension property, a SGA2 thing, basically. And I don't want to talk about it because I haven't studied it for a long time. And so it has escaped my memory what exactly it means. But you have this extension property. And if you have an integral model, which is not only smooth, but also satisfies the extension property in the sense of Vasio and Milne, then it automatically is unique. So the question whether the integral model that I constructed and agrees with the usual integral canonical model of Kiesin and Vasio, it amounts to two things. First question is, is the level structure KP, which I was forced to swipe under the rug because it's too complicated. This thing I called KP, is this a hyperspecial level structure? Mm-hmm. Because if it wasn't, it wouldn't even be a model. It would be certainly an interesting thing, but not a model of that respective Shimura variety. Second question is, wait a second. Does this thing here, you know, you remember the commutative diagram here, I've got, in the bottom, I've got a polyunitary moduli problem in terms of abelian varieties. And here I have the polyunitary moduli problem in terms of p-divisible groups, and I have this thing over it. So the question is the canonical lift, which is described by this thing, does this satisfy the extension property? And I think that is also a doable problem. I mean, you would simply have to take a look at the papers of Vasiu and Tsing, who proved this for abelian varieties. I think it's called Purity of Abelian Varieties, I think is the title. And you would simply have to prove the analog of these papers, not for the stack of p-divisible groups, but for the stack BG mu. You would have to write a paper of which the title is Purity of BG mu, right? I mean, as opposed to Purity of p-divisible groups. And I'm a little bit naive, but it sounds like a doable problem. Maybe not an easy problem, but it sounds doable. So I am rather optimistic on this. I think that at some time one will be able to prove these two questions. I think that KP is hyperspecial, that should be settled. I think that's possible, and it should also be settled that this thing up here satisfies the extension property in the sense of Vasiu and Milne. I mean, again, it's probably harder than I think, but I think it's worth thinking about it.
Then very naturally, so the next question that comes to my mind is that, I mean, the counting question about the, I mean, once you come up with that sort of integral model, then there's like the Kissing's result and the counting type of things for the special fiber of
yes.
the canonical mm-hmm. model. And then, mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, how would it look like then here with this sort of integral models?
Well,
okay.
Counting points, I mean, the points one wants to count are typically in characteristic P. So this is very nice because the last step in this proof can be omitted anyway. So you might remember this line here. The lift is exhibited by requiring that the map to BG mu extends to, mm-hmm. to the integral model. You can ignore this because the points are already given by this structure with mm-hmm. the bar and M bar. Mm-hmm. So I am inclined to say that with respect to counting points over finite fields, this module is perhaps even more approachable than the ones by Kissing and Vasiu.
I see. Mm-hmm.
Because you have a moduli interpretation. Mm-hmm. And Vasiu do not have a moduli interpretation for mm-hmm. the special fiber. They construct it artificially by the risky closure. And then what you get in the special fiber is basically the work of, higher powers. I mean higher forces and ghosts. You know. And, so in this sense,
looks closer to the function field setup.
It's very promising. I think the counting points on this thing is sounds like a very promising project. For example, you could start with looking at the paper of Kotwitz, which does it for PEL Shimura varieties, and maybe the methods carry over. This is possible.
Mm-hmm. 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 And then the question about I mean, you have said something about non-emptiness, and then perhaps this is also tightly related to the non-emptiness of certain affine delinguistic varieties.
Well,
In fact,
there is a theorem of a person I use in the middle of my paper. I use a theorem of I'm not sure I pronounce this name correctly, but I think this perhaps answers your question. It's something like Gaffi or Kumri or so. Well, I don't find this now. I mean, well, I don't know. I sorry for getting this distracted. So, it is certainly related, because to prove M is non-empty, I mean you have to do two things. You have to find a point here which is giving you something down there. So you have a given Newton polygon, and you want to have a crystal with G structure that has a prescribed Hodge polygon, and there's a theorem of this for this by a guy from Albania, I think Gaffi or Kimrin or something like this. Mm-hmm. And you can do it with this way. However, the non-emptiness of this is can be rather serious. So in some cases I prove the non-emptiness of this thing for a sufficient number of examples, but in the most general setting there are also some cases where this is empty. So one has to be very careful about it. I don't really have a satisfactory answer for it. So I have a little lemma, and it uses the Tejchafarevich group of Torai, and it uses all sorts of other things. So I don't really, I guess the answer to your question is rather no. So I don't think that the non-emptiness of M has anything to do with the non-emptiness of affine delinear Lustig varieties, which Reumann, for example, has studied a lot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Some results of hair also comes to my mind, but okay.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much for your very beautiful talk and for answering my questions.
You are welcome.
I have a question, but keep in mind, I mean, some of the material is completely unknown to me, so it may be a little bit asking for some explanation of passage between finite characteristic and characteristic zero. During your talk, you mentioned there was it was possible to make the passage between the two, and I sort of don't quite understand what the two things are connected.
Well, it's a good point. So There are some peculiar shifts between characteristic P and characteristic zero. You know, it starts out from the tensor product abelian variety. The tensor product abelian variety is defined rigorously only for the complex number field with the tool of Hodge structures. And then you use the Delimius theory of absolute Hodge cycles, and with a little bit of extra luck to prove that it also works in characteristic P. So as I said, one can pretend this was a special case of the Keyes Invasio story, but one can also make an independent proof of it, which avoids it. It's found in my paper entitled Construction of Abelian Varieties with Given Monodromy. And so this is already one step in the proof, where methods of characteristic P where methods of characteristic zero are applied to things in characteristic P. And a bit later, there's another shift from between the two characteristics. So you have Shimura varieties are basically characteristic zero objects. So you start with a double quotient. So that's certainly a characteristic zero thing. And you want a good reduction for this. And I approach this by using characteristic P methods, by first constructing a characteristic P scheme and then lift it with the remark that the deformations theory of the stack BG mu, which was studied by Hidayatsadeh and myself, sort of leads to this. So, so this is the second point where things of characteristic it goes in the opposite direction. I first apply characteristic zero methods to something in characteristic P, and in this setting here, in this context, I apply characteristic P methods to get something in characteristic zero. So the missing link, of course, is also Grothendieck's existence theory, which tells you that if you have a sequence of lifts of a characteristic P projective variety, then it gives you a projective variety also in characteristic zero. So this is just EJA, the EJA 3, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the talk as well.
Thank you, Oliver.
One more question is, in the passage when, if you're in these passages, if you do transfers from different characteristics P to characteristic zero, do you end up getting the same related objects in characteristic zero from characteristic P1 and characteristic P2, let's say?
Well, I think this sounds similar to a question that somebody else asked. Okay. So one cannot only prove the existence of integral canonical models by means of Keesin and Vasio, but one knows they are unique. And the uniqueness theorem of the integral models does not need the Hodge type assumption. So it is... it is more, I think it should be known that if you have two integral models, both satisfying the extension property, then they should be the same. So in particular, the models which I construct, they are equal to the usual ones, if and only if one can prove that BG mu satisfies an analog of the purity papers of Vasio and Zink. And that would be a really cool project to do. So I.
Oh, can I ask a question, mm-hmm. Oliver? Mm-hmm. Oh, actually, you said that Keeson and Vasio's method is a passage from characteristic zero to characteristic P, or vice versa. I forgot you just said. So is it hard? Connected to Fontaine, Wittenberge theory kind of thing, which relates characteristic P and characteristic zero local objects.
Uh-huh. I didn't know about the Fontaine.
No. I mean, I'm just asking whether in the heart of the material, is there such thing? Because Fontaine-Wittenberge theory connects characteristic P and characteristic zero local fields. I mean, because of that, I just asked.
Oh, I see. Are you talking about the this thing of called the field of norms or so?
Exactly, yeah.
Oh, yes. I don't think it's related. I
see. Mm-hmm. And all this constructing integral canonical model is related to counting points, right? In over finite fields, right?
It's not immediately related, but since Kiesin and Vasu have shown this beautiful result, it cries for counting the points on them in order to apply it to the Langlands project, for example.
You want writing down the zeta function, right? To write
exactly. You need the point counting business in order to compute the L function of the mod P reduction. And
so in your work, for example, polyunitary setting, let's say.
Yes.
Did you able to write down the zeta function?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. I think one should study the points of this thing over a finite field, and right. I think that's possible. And I think the fun aspect of this problem, as I said it already, is that one could do it without knowing whether this is an actually integral canonical model. I conjecture it is an integral canonical model. However, it is just some model, and so why not count its points?
Right. Yeah, great. Yeah, thanks for the nice talk.
Thanks for inviting me again.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
Thank you very much again.
You're welcome. Thanks for attending. Okay. Any more remarks? or,